Last year I did a video on Digimon World Next Order, where I talked about the first Digimon World game as well, since that was a huge part of my childhood. I purposely skimmed over the middle child of this trilogy, and I said I'd talk about a Digimon game a year later. Well, it's been a year, now it's time to look at my favourite Digimon World games. The reason for that plural is because Digimon World Redigitized was initially a PSP game, released towards the end of that system's lifespan, and then they gave it an improved port a little later for a host of new features on the next generation portable, the 3DS. Yeah, weirdly this wasn't on Vita, which you may expect since the next game in this series was initially exclusive to it, but Bandai gave Nintendo some love for once. Though none of this love made it internationally, since both of these games were, and still are, Japan exclusives, unless you have fan translations to make them accessible. Interestingly enough, while both of these games are nearly the same in terms of text, the PSP version goes for the fan sub route and uses the terminology those fans would be more familiar with, while the 3DS version goes for the more typical official English terms. So in short, the PSP has, for example, Vandemon, whereas the 3DS uses Myotismon, and the PSP will use terms like child and adult, while the 3DS sides with rookie and champion. Either way, they're both easy to understand, just know what you're in for if you're some kind of strict purist. You may be wondering, why am I even wasting my time on the PSP version? But I already admitted the 3DS is generally better across the board. And that's because I want to better appreciate the changes and additions here. Plus, I still have a PSP bias, and I need to support that thing. When we start the game, we're immediately greeted with a difference, since the 3DS has an additional animated cutscene here to set up the story. We can see something has gone wrong with technology somewhere, but the scope of it and those affected by it aren't made clear yet. After that, both games sync up, and we see our presumably teenage boy protagonist ride home on his bike. He's from a present-day Japanese city, and like all of us, he immediately games once he gets home. Though in his case, it's Digimon Battle, since he and the group that he's interacting with are all online Digimon battlers. Thanks to our boy typing in some words he's heard before, when prompted, this group is sucked into the digital world. But this is for the world's good, since things were falling apart there. Our boy, who I named Freeze SP and Freeze DS accordingly, is talking to an Agumon who was actually our partner Digimon when we battled him. Unfortunately, in this game, we don't get to choose our starter like we do in the other games. Though the Agumon we have here during the opening is very talkative, and that makes up for it, even if his artwork is a little bit freaky in this context. I love the heavily shaded Digimon artwork, but it doesn't suit my friendly big-headed dinosaur when he's here helping me. For the rest of the game though, this art style is my jam. I love it. I named this partner buddy Bitey and Biter accordingly. I was slightly more clever the second time. But after that, all my buddies were named after my Patreon backers. I sure hope none of you people turn out to be horrible, awful people years later. It'll make this really awkward. Almost as awkward as our best friend we meet here, who does develop a little throughout the story, but he spends most of the opening complaining about the girl here, and he is just an awful sexist prick. He also called her a tomboy, and she's like the least tomboy person I can imagine. Then again, we had people in our real world say the same thing about Princess Peach in a movie, so, you know, I guess it's not that bizarre, is it? Anyway, in addition to sexist boy and pink girl, we also have rich boy and purple woman. I'm sure they have names, they're even on the screen now in the video, but for the life of me, I just can't remember the names of the human characters in this era of Digimon games. It would take some actually emotional writing to change that. This group being here is bizarre, since humans aren't meant to be in the digital world after all, especially this many who all arrived around the same time. But that's the least of the world's concerns because of a bigger threat we learn is named VTM, and it's making its home here. The main city here is also falling apart. It used to be a bustling place, but now is a shell of its former self, with far fewer residents and less commerce. Unfortunately, the design of File City here stays the same all game. You don't get to see new buildings spring to life, which was so rewarding in the two other world games like this. They do at least give us the courtesy of opening up previously closed off buildings throughout the game, so there is change mechanically, it just doesn't look very different. This town is basically our hub, and we will spring forth into an increasingly varied and fascinating world that gets more dangerous the further we travel. The first of these is where we technically started, and it's one of two zones immediately available from File City. Railroad Plains is a beautiful introductory area, and a great callback to the original anime, which featured a biome like this. It's our grassy plains area, but with trains, railways, and things of that nature littering the map, and it surprisingly blends wonderfully into a coastal area where we can learn the important tasks of fishing and walking on water. An out there skill, I know, but it means we get a creative as hell zone later, and the fishing itself, it's pretty boilerplate, but I love how dramatic it is, especially when you miss or even just pull your line too early. This game makes you feel like a failure. The open skies we see here and few obstacles make a great place to come to terms with the game's mechanics, and we just get to witness beautiful time of day changes in full glory. The full 3D camera rotation is done really well in game, and it lets us better appreciate these spectacular biomes and all the variation they encompass. Unfortunately, you do have to claw your systems properly to utilize this, since the PSP and 3DS map the camera control to the D-pad, which is right by the circle pads they use for movement. Thankfully, basic horizontal movement, which is all you really need, is done with the shoulder buttons. Controlling it fully is just for when you're feeling fancy. And if you are some kind of person who is emulating this on a system with two sticks, the camera control works quite well. It's here that we really familiarize ourselves with the gameplay loop. To the people who played the two world games like this, the gameplay here is basically a middle ground between them. It's built off the original base, but with the easier difficulty and better communication with the player, as well as all the perks of being a 3D game that we saw in Next Order a few years later. But for the billions of people out there who never play these niche games, but are watching my video, obviously, this is basically an RPG with a map split into distinct zones, but it's also some kind of weird virtual pet game, where you have to raise these guys from birth to death. The Digimon tell us when they're hungry, when they're sleepy, when they're going to poop, or whenever they're sick or fatigued. They're really communicative guys, and they evolve over the days and die peacefully many more days later. And they come complete with reincarnation when they die of old age, which helps make the next generation feel more powerful than the previous, and it means you don't have to be too sad, because it's not like they really died or anything, they got to become a baby again, and I don't know, don't think about it too much, don't get too attached, okay? These maps have no random encounters, since you see all the enemies on the map, and they beeline towards you for a fight, sometimes with a nearby friend included too. Basically, battles are kind of automated for the most part, though you can control some tactics, and eventually, you do get the option to choose individual moves for the Digimon if they have a very high brain stat. Though that's rarely a necessity, since you can only equip 3 moves at a time to a Digimon, so you'll just prioritize the good ones and that cover multiple types and statuses, the Digimon will make good choices. For the battles, the strategy is basically autopiloting it, and then you cheat by using healing items. That's all Digimon World is. It's a comfort kind of thing, but I can see why a lot of people wouldn't like this weird style of battle. The battles are not the highlights here by any means. Though sometimes you do get to do a special attack, and that's when a Digimon fills up its specific meter, and here in Redigitize, that meter actually carries over to different battles. So if you ended a battle with it being filled, you could start the next battle and immediately unload the special attack you earned earlier. We get lots of status afflictions here, you know, the usual stuff like poison and so forth, but my favourite is the Digimon World staple of turning your partner Digimon into the little virtual pet pixel art. I love it. This has always been my favourite status type in any of these games, and here we still have the black and white originals. The sequel gave it the modern colorized ones, which are nice, but they're here in this game in a different role. That way my aging heart still gets to appreciate the original 90s look in battle. The colorful pixel art is used for menus and stuff, which I think is a better role, since it just needs to convey a tiny but distinct icon that you can easily recognize. When it's for battles, I don't need to immediately recognize it, I just need a blob of pixels. But since there is more to battles than nostalgia of virtual pets from the 90s, let's return to the main topic. Keep spamming attacks, or sometimes use strategy. The difficulty curve of battles is gradual, though noticeably on PSP, it started off a lot more challenging, like the original game for PlayStation. But on 3DS, it was far too easy, more like the sequel for Vita. Both balanced out later on for the most part, but at the start, the difficulty difference was stark between these two releases. It left me initially preferring the less feature-complete Sony version. Battles were tougher and felt more dramatic, as well as the rewards you get for it not being as high, and I kind of liked the game being tough. But on 3DS, there was no challenge here, which wasn't my preference. But like I said, things did change throughout. This game just goes a lot easier on you in the very beginning. It's treating it more like a tutorial of sorts, just to get new players acclimatized to this weird type of gameplay. This gulf will shrink over time, and both games will be more on par with difficulty, though the 3DS one is generally easier across the board for a lot of reasons. And after reading interviews, I can see why they made this change. They wanted battles to feel more rewarding by having higher stat growths for when you complete it, and they wanted battles to be easier so they weren't as punishing. On the PSP, battles sometimes felt like a chore. You'd only really do it to learn new moves, which wasn't a common reward. But on the 3DS, battles are more justified and more welcoming. Especially, as I keep saying, a lot of people aren't familiar with this weird type of Digimon world, and they really wanted to make sure more people could get into it. Once you're let off the leash, and the difficulty gets a bit better for 3DS, I like that version more in like every single way. Well, almost every way. Item menu on PSP is a nice efficient list, but on 3DS, it's a bulkier affair with giant touchscreen icons, which while they look nice, does make it more tedious due to the page switching, and that's not great in the heat of battle. Also on PSP, it only shows the items you'd need to use during battle, whereas on 3DS, it shows you everything. So yeah, that's a knock against the 3DS version. You won't hear that too often. The UI for battles is obviously different between both releases, and I don't really have a specific preference, except for the fact that on 3DS, it actually has an area to show the stats, like attack, defense, and speed, which could be temporarily buffed during battle. I love being able to visually see that, it's great and it often reminded me to use these buffs that I sometimes forgot about on PSP. Regardless of the version of the game, we'll be traversing this train-themed field until we find a dark portal where this weird little guy called VTM emerges. It's some kind of powerful being that attacks the sexist friend instinctively. Good for them. Oh no, wait, if you made a different choice earlier in the game, it attacks the pinkhead girl and she gets hit. Okay, that's not good. I don't like you anymore, VDM. I'm just kidding, look at you, you're so cute. I love you. But after defeating this cute little guy, we learn that this strange being is corrupting the land, and we must put an end to it by finding these same kind of corrupted areas all across the digital world. There is one in every biome, and upon defeating whatever we have to defeat there, we pick up garbage data that our protagonist can read. As the game progresses, these become more in-depth messages from VDM as it learns its identity and place in the world. The these are fun little reads. This opening area also shows us even more of 3DS's newer content. All the characters get more fleshing out across the entire game, but early on, we get a small moment where we play as the sexist, and another where we help and learn more of the backstory of Pink Girl. This also gives us an earlier introduction to double battles, which are moments in the story where we have to team up with another Digimon, usually one of our friends, and we both get to unleash on the target. So you don't control that other Digimon directly, you're just on healing duty for them as well. It doesn't really add much for the gameplay, but it's used in these boss encounters and other moments that the game wants you to feel like it's a spectacular adventure that multiple Digimon need to complete. Even if you don't need their help, it's nice feeling like you do. It makes it feel like your friends aren't dead weight, and I love that. But now, the game really begins. You're still guided on where to go, but at this point, you're free to explore and discover that this game is in fact Side Quest Central. But in a fun way, I promise. Though some of these seeming side quests do turn out to be mandatory much later on, the game still reveals itself to be all about helping all these Digimon across the map, having them join File City, and you know, sometimes you get to fight the central antagonist and save the digital world. This loop of just doing odd jobs while time is always ticking puts me at minds of games like Majora's Mask, where it's just this constant vibe of low-level anxiety and time management, combined with a nice feeling that you get for helping make these characters' lives better. Once again, this is very much not a game for everyone, but it is for some of us. And as everyone knew, the only problem with Majora's Mask was Link didn't have a dependent child to look after. Thankfully, Digimon World Redigitized answers that longing. This cycle really started after my Greymon in both games passed away, and I got to select an egg for the reincarnation. The 3DS version one-upped it by telling you which Digimon will hatch from eggs that you've already used, and which rookies you can potentially get if you've already seen them before. On PSP, you're not given nearly as much information. Reincarnations also let you save the data of the previously deceased Digimon, so you can continue to use their special attacks, though these are limited uses at first, and something I honestly never used, but it's a small bonus that doesn't hurt the game at all. You can use it, and that's cool, or you don't use it, and no harm is done. For the kinds of people who get weirdly attached to a single Digimon, having this data still travel with you, and sometimes do special attacks, can really make it feel like that Digimon is still with you in some form. So I'm not going to complain about its existence, even if, like I said, I never used it. Anyway, for the second generation of Digimon traveling with me, I got Animal and Ronin, two blobs that eventually became Garurumon and Mameymon, respectively. The 3DS version tried to make it an easier and quicker experience to meet evolutionary requirements, which is why my second generation guy on 3DS got to the ultimate stage, while PSP Garurumon died of old age at Champion. With these two growing friends, I explored more of the world that Greymon initially led me through, this being Signpost Forest, a beautifully wooded paradise filled with, well, signposts, but it also has electrical cords, outlets, and other things you'd expect from the Digimon world. It also deserves special highlight because it has my favorite track in the game. All the music in this game is nice, and when it's nighttime, it's not just nice, those songs are redone to be more upbeat variations. It's the same song, but someone just turned it from comfort music to a full-on jam. And Nighttime Signpost Forest is my favorite. It's also when I first noticed this trend, since my Greymon was a very early sleeper. All Digimon here have their own sleep schedules, and I first noticed the bop of the soundtrack here with my second generation. Look, all I'm saying is the game gets a lot better if you have nocturnal guys like Merrimon or Devimon, that way you get to always hear these bops. It's also here that I first noticed the attention to detail extended to the public toilets. Look, I know this isn't much, but these world games always have places for Digimon to do their business. And unlike Next Order, which always had the same toilets everywhere, here we get unique ones for each and every biome, like a hollowed out tree in the swamp, or a tent in the snow-riddled north. I love the variation we get for toilets of all things. After these two introductory zones, we're given a choice on where to go next, though you do need to do both. It's just which area you do first is your choice, and you get to tailor the experience according to which Digimon you have, since there are type advantages, and you might not want to bring your fire guy to the water area, for example. These two new areas are the submerged ruins and the ancient bone swamp. Two places you'll get wet in regardless, but they're radically different areas, and they really get to show the creativity of team. Look, we have an entire area that is water above a sunken city, rocks and coral sticking out above the dry land, while we walk on a city that makes no sense. And thanks to the biomes all bleeding together, it all feels natural. We can get here from Railroad Plains' coastal area, or Signpost Forest, which had a moment that exited out onto water. The fight at Memorial Stella, the little areas where Vidium and its companions are, on the PSP, this was entirely sectioned off. But on 3DS, they made it so that fight appears in this little open ocean-y area, but you can't find the important MacGuffin that you need, because it's all the way on another island. This wasn't just a fun shake-up, but it more importantly reinforced the entire ethos of the game. Because to get to the island, we need some kind of friend that can help us traverse the ocean. And this is solved back in File City, where there's lots of baby Digimon, and across the 3DS version, we need to help them all evolve. And here, we do that and we're rewarded with a Waymon. The Waymon is so grateful that he rides us to that island. They'll become a recurring character on top of that, but we even get to do things like a fishing competition or just walk around on its back. I love it. The 3DS version kind of went overboard with helping lots of different babies, but it's usually optional and I love it nonetheless, and I try to do it whenever I'm able to, because to me, this is what Redigitize is all about. It is this journey of helping lots of individuals with their problems, more so than some kind of grand epic story. The game rewarding you with plot progression is more satisfying when it comes from doing something small that rippled, as opposed to the frankly more barren PSP version, which for the same encounter just had us walk into a room, beat up a guy, and leave. The same kind of 3DS moment also applied in the swamp, but here it's for an optional side quest more so than something completely mandatory. But here we get to see a dying Cherrymon, and he wants us to help him achieve his last wish. Unfortunately, Cherrymon passed away before he could see the results of it. In his wake, a giant towering fungus blooms, and this becomes home to lots of extra Digimon who each came here to see the amazing view, and some of them have their own problems that need solving. On PSP, this bittersweet moment of helping a dying creature and seeing the joy that came from it just isn't there. But on PSP, it never feels like things are missing, because nothing is missing. The PSP is still a complete game. It never feels lacking. It's just when you play the 3DS version, you can see it turbocharged everything, and the original looks barren in comparison. Thankfully, regardless of which version you play, my favorite moment of the game's humor is still here in all its glory. We're told by a Digimon that we can't proceed any further because the swamp water gets too deep, and he suggests we make some kind of bridge to cross over it. For this, we need lots and lots of rocks, so painstakingly gather them. Once that's finally done, the Digimon reveals he was just messing with us and the water is actually shallow, and he just lets us walk on past. But they felt so bad for tricking us, they joined the city anyway. It is much funnier in execution than my dry, flavorless recap, so I'm sorry I ruined one of my favorite moments of the game. Who am I kidding, you're not gonna play this anyway. The swamp is also home to Birdramon, who will be our fast travel taxi, and this becomes essential as we continue playing and and explore further and further from File City. Also, I just love that whenever we ride on Berdrumon, we briefly see our Digimon on the ground sprinting to catch up. This is way funnier than it should be, and they didn't need to show it. Anyway, behind that previously inaccessible water is this whole other biome you're not meant to go to for a while, but the game is happy for you to bumble in here and get destroyed. It's Night Canyon, an area that thankfully has a daytime version and isn't just the same one color constantly. But to get back to where the game wants me to go, it's Sewer Maze. A rare example of a genuinely beautiful video game sewer. It's also one of those areas that doesn't change between day and night due to it being underground. Though unlike the sequel to this, it's a lot more justified here since this is entirely sheltered from the sky. We also get a choice of going to Fluorescent Cave. This is another example of the game giving you two zones to tackle in either order that you feel like. And given the amount of Digimon and their type advantages, I love this freedom here. This cave is also sheltered from the sky, so we don't get the same type of variation, but once again, it's fitting here, and it's so beautiful that I don't mind. It's hard to pick a favorite zone aesthetically in the entire game, especially with some like Night Canyon or the desert coming up later, which pop at night but just leave me content during the day. But Fluorescent Cave is definitely the one that left the biggest first impression on me visually when I first saw it. It's gorgeous. Speaking of gorgeous, there is a mansion in Fluorescent Cave, which at one point houses this Digimon who serves so much cunt. Look at him. Now for these sections of the story, I had with me on my PSP my third generation buddy Josh as a Seadramon and later Mega Seadramon, whereas on 3DS with its easier difficulty and the longer lifespan provided by the Ultimate, I was still using my first post-Greymon Digimon. Ronan, the Kakumon, and later Mamemon were still here, and he saw large portions of the game during these locations. I was actually worried about this initially, since I like the turbulence of Digimon dying and being reincarnated, and I like having to restart with these games a lot. But for reasons I'll get to later, the game provided enough to do that even on 3DS, I got to see lots of friends die. I didn't mean for that to sound so morbid. Early on, I was genuinely kind of resenting all these tweaks to the 3DS balance, but like I said, I was able to appreciate it later. I also learned to appreciate all the extra money I was earning and saving from not needing to buy as many healing items. I was initially upset that I just had too much money in the game. But on the 3DS version specifically, I got addicted to collecting trading cards that you can buy. On PSP, I barely touched this mechanic because money was spent on better things, like keeping my Digimon alive and happy. If you ever find yourself thinking the money balance on 3DS is off, give in to the dark side and buy lots of packs of these cards, or keep feeding your Digimon nothing but expensive meals. To get away from shitty financial advice, and to get back to the part of the game filled with shit, the sewers are a nice, stinky breath of fresh air. I love all the zones in the game, but this does rank on the lower end for me, unfortunately. Even though, like I said earlier, this is gorgeous by sewer standards. I love the choice of colors here, and the hanging lights, and the overall brightness for what should be a decrepit and dank cavern. I think my biggest issue just comes with the questing here. Like, we get this really horrible side quest, where Kakumon won't leave until we clean up all the poop here, which thankfully can be done quite easily. The problem is just finding each and every bit of poop here. It is tedious on both versions, and it's a horrible Easter egg hunt. This whole quest notwithstanding, the sewers are a fine environment, and I have nothing against them besides some of the rooms looking a little samey. Though that is once again made better on 3DS, which provides a map on the bottom screen at all times. Well, all times besides the times you want to check Digita, a fun but repetitive gag where we see Digimon in the area posting their updates about what they're thinking, and even the main characters give little updates. Though both versions still have you receive emails, which can keep you from getting lost, and you can also get thank you messages from all the Digimon you've helped across the game. Also, on that note, Gigimon in File City will instruct you on where to go for the main story. basically, there is a lot here to keep you from getting lost, so this is the kind of game you can drop for several months or even years, and still pick up and complete easily. But just to signpost many of the enhancements of the 3DS version in rapid fire, we get more information presented directly to the player, we have more Digimon in the wild to battle, as well as more Digimon for us to use. There are more quests, more areas on the map to explore, and two optional but sizable time wasters, being the 100th floor dungeon Mount Infinity, and more importantly, running a hotel that gives you passive income, which is a great way to fuel my addiction to buying trading cards. Though that hotel's a little half-baked, as it boils down to you helping Digimon who stay there, and they all want the same handful of repetitive tasks from you. And while I don't have an encyclopedic knowledge of every aspect of this game, unfortunately, during pre-release interviews, the game was said to have doubled the amount of advance, and I'd certainly believe it, even if it is probably slightly exaggerated due to PR spin. The intention here was to kind of make a pseudo-sequel as well as port of the old game, so there is no doubt this has a lot of extra content. And the extra areas on the map I mentioned, they're not new biomes, but little offshoots to the existing ones, sometimes with a really different feeling atmosphere. Like we got the train graveyard and railroad plains, the Cherrymon Observatory I mentioned earlier in the swamp, and there's other areas like Night Canyon that has this whole tunnel that can lead to both Sewer Maze and Fluorescent Cave. But on its own, it's also a bar for Digimon who'd rather hang out here than live in a city. In addition to those, there is a small room for Wizardmon to brew potions in the Sewer Maze, and at the end of the game, we get to explore an abandoned husk of ship debris. Since I've gone through so many generations, and at this stage am close to losing my Mamemon, it's about time I go into how training works, because that'll be a big part of the game each time an egg hatches with a new reincarnation. For Redigitize specifically, the game wants you to train at File City's gym, though there are some extra areas to train across the game with more advanced methods. But later on, these advanced methods are brought to File City. Each training regime is a different timed minigame. Sometimes they're based on more mental skills, like determining which line is the safe one to pick, but more often than that, they're reaction-based. You can pick different levels of difficulty, and you get higher rewards depending on which one you pick. Unlike the other games, these are much more skill-based, which may be someone's preference, but since the other games had more luck involved, I personally felt like it wasn't my fault when I lost. Whereas here, I know it's my fault when I lose, and I just feel worse for it. There are ways to further increase the benefits you get from the gym as well, like holding a special item to increase the rewards, or having a different Digimon run the gym, since there are two different feuding bug Digimon, and each can run this place, and when they do, certain stats get extra benefits when they're in charge. The gym here is the best in the series, and that's only cause when you fail this one specific game, they drop a log on your Digimon, and that's funny to me, look at it. One thing to be aware of is on PSP, your stats can only max out at 999. On 3DS with its beefier end game, that I'll get to much later, these are increased dramatically, so you should never be able to max out the counters like I did on PSP. And it's easier to get these wild improvements on the 3DS with a new decode system, something in place basically to make it feel like you're improving over the course of a game. It's a rank that increases the more you do events, and the higher the number, the better your Digimon stats will be. Personally, it's not something I really needed, but I've also come to accept that not every game is made for me specifically. They kind of made this to make it feel more like an RPG, and no matter what you do, you're always leveling up and working towards something. But to get back to the story, we got to explore the beautiful gravel wasteland, and it's much prettier than it sounds, especially at nighttime. Mega Seedramon Josh and Ronin Marimon set out to explore this, only for Ronin to pass away and be replaced with just Andre the Galgamon, who finished it all off for me. This zone manages to bring the story more front and center, which is nice. Sometimes the game isn't just going to the toilet or boosting the population of a city, there's actually a story here. And when we're here on 3DS, we're interrupted with an Ogremon who needs to bring us to his master. Obviously, we beat him to a pulp and don't go anywhere. But this is accompanied by an extra cutscene of Ogremon pleading with a mysterious off-screen presence in a dark void. This got me really excited for some story that I knew wouldn't be on PSP since it didn't have this entire scene. But even the lesser original version gets something nice, since both games here, we get to see more of Dr. Petrov. He was introduced a little earlier, before we got to the desert. Something was obviously wrong with the scientist, as he was trying to make VTM, the perfect program as he described it, even more powerful. And that led to a climactic battle against his corrupted Metal Greymon. Oh yeah, Dr. Petrov is also Sex's boy's dad. And seeing his distress over this actually made me like him more. While I still hate his guts, seeing this teenage boy plead with his dad, who was frankly no longer his dad, actually got to me a little. Not much, this isn't some kind of really emotional story, but it was enough to almost make me remember Sex's boy's name. I know it has a Petrov in there somewhere. In the desert, we fight with another VTM, but this time it ends with Dr. Petrov breaking through and talking to us, and gives us instructions on where to go next for us to break him free from all this. He's perhaps the most interesting character to come from this. He's a research technician working for the technology giant Gigo, and during that time, he created a new kind of life form. This being VTM. Though Petrov couldn't have been aware of the issues that would arise from this, or the fact that he and a bunch of kids would get trapped inside the digital world because of it, he was essentially a creator of new life, and now he's paying the consequences of it as it's taking over. My favorite aspect of all this is the evolving thoughts of VTM that I mentioned earlier. It really does develop a sense of identity, and watching that slowly evolve was a fun moment that made the meandering boss fights more rewarding. Thanks to Dr. Petrov, we're now instructed to go to Night Canyon. That silly game, I was already here earlier. Though now there's actually more that we can do. A whole second half that wasn't previously accessible has now been opened. I loved that the game managed to have its cake and eat it too here, in regards to letting us see this later zone much earlier, so even if we explored every inch that we could have, there's a whole other area that was previously blocked off. And this whole zone is one of my favorites to look at. I love the neon lights here, especially at night because I'm shallow, and I like pretty things. And it also houses the Tentomon that sells my trading cards. So this is my favorite location because it fuels my addiction. After this return trip, we make our way back to the tower in File City. It's a giant monument looming over everything that will become even more important later on. But for now, it's where we do Colosseum battles. It's also how we enter the exclusive 100th floor dungeon from the 3DS. It does it all, doesn't it? Colosseum battles first seem like an optional part of the game, and I love them. But by this point, the game is making it abundantly clear that this is mandatory, so get fighting or else you can't see the rest of the story. The Colosseum is split into 5 different levels, each with their own special gimmicks. And in these, we have to fight other Digimon battlers, and there's lots of cute interactions here, but the one of most import are the many cameos of characters from the Digimon anime series, including the dude who punches everything. The art style of all these does clash a lot, and it's not my favorite, but this is cute fan service, so don't take it too seriously, and I wouldn't expect them to redraw all these in the same style. They're just throwaway moments. Though we also do get another character who turns out to be crucial to the story, and she's a character from Tekken. I had no idea until I was nearly done with the game, because I haven't played a Tekken game in over 20 years, but still. Over the course of the game, I used basically every Digimon I had at Neath, especially since you get some nice rewards, and more importantly, cool cosmetics. Yeah, you can dress up your Digimon. This is the best part of the game. Look at it! And look at this! Oh, and you can't forget about this! There are so many looks here. But for the story to proceed, you have to make it past the ordinary battle floors. The tameless battle floors, where it's all AI. The timed battle floors, where we have time limits, obviously. And we have to make it to the double battles floor, which, well, is all double battles. And during all this ascending, we even get battles with our friends, complete with extra dialogue that really fleshes them out more. Well, you get that on 3DS, the PSP didn't do this. Also, if you take some time out to read these news stories here, we get more lore about the real world, including news reports that Petrov has gone missing, and the disappearance of all these kids. This is a nice read, even if it is a little grim, and it helps remind us that there is an outside world there that is now featuring fewer people who have basically gone from the face of the earth. Anyway, at the 40th floor, it's here that our group of friends argue what is the best decision to make regarding all this garbage data we're collecting. Two of our friends want to destroy it, thinking it'd do harm to have it, whereas the other two are more trusting and want to keep it. This is a genuine choice. It won't impact too much, but the next zone you do is entirely different, depending on which of these choices you make, and there are some small story effects rippling because of this. So Freeze SP and Elliot the Blue Merrimon kept the garbage data, and on my other playthrough, Freeze DS and Just Andre destroyed it. This meant for the PSP, I was onto Bonkeno Volcano. It's a nice molten location, and I liked it just because the stairs here reminded me of the Nintendo 64 Zelda stairs. Look at them. And onto the 3DS, I was onto the place that I'd obviously prefer, the freezing, powdery cliffs. I'm in love. Look, it's snowing, it's frozen, it's miserable, it's perfect. Plus the combination of this environment and all these abandoned ships here made me think of the Barkov bomb from Hitman Contracts. And that made me happy and nostalgic. Both of these are fun, near end of game locations, representing the hottest and coldest locations possible. And I really like that the game makes you have a choice here, and the small story ramifications from it. You're still free to explore both regions if you want to, and you do want to, don't you? So you can't see all of the game here, and you're not locked off from anything. So once again, the game has its cake and eats it too. And I mean that in a good way, I don't want it to sound negative. It's genuinely good that the game makes you choose while not punishing you for your choice. This isn't some kind of story-based RPG or short but highly replayable game that would be better served by the philosophy of locking you off and making you replay the whole game from beginning. This is a chill, casual game about helping everyone at your own pace, minus the constant need to keep your Digimon from defecating publicly or starving. By the way, I don't know when else to mention this, so I'll do it now, but if your Digimon poops in public, it actually litters the map like the original, but more importantly, it has physics so you can kick it around when you run into it. I love it. Also, on a less poopy note, there are small showcases of things like this rubbish bin that will jiggle if you run into it. For my simple brain, that was endlessly entertaining. Unfortunately, after all these really exciting biomes, the game draws to a close in the most boring place imaginable. Binary Castle. This can be entered by either of the preceding zones, and it's a set of grey rooms with very little going on. And there's no day or night variations as well since it's all roofed off. We don't even get nice little distractions like fishing, it's just grey boxes. It does come with these devices that lets you speed or slow the passage of time, which is a nice thing to throw in at the end. Though I never really used it, I can't imagine some people who want to slow down their time to keep their friend alive longer, or the kinds of people who want to fast forward to a specific point of the game so they can do a quest or something, like ones that require specific hours. I was too lazy to use these beyond testing, however. For how little I like the zone, I do like where the plot goes here in this final locale. We get more VTM doing their little thing, more Petrov, a sexist guy is attacked, you know, it's all good. Plus here, after all this, we finally see the sky above us is now corrupting. This beautiful, warming blue of daylight turns into cold darkness, and this is basically permanent for the rest of the game. And for that rest of the game, we need to go back to File City and access a previously inaccessible part of that Colosseum tower. I do find it a little underwhelming to end the game here in this tower, as opposed to a wholly new locale, but also I can kind of see it as a really great way to bookend the game. File City is where our journey truly started, that's where things will end. And this giant tower loomed over us even before we entered the city proper. It's been this inescapable presence, so I do get the merits here, even if I would have preferred something even newer. And this endgame area is really climactic. This whole group, who are now truly friends as their bonds have strengthened all game, are now taking on the final forces to reach VTM. The game uses double battles here wonderfully, and it really does make you feel like your friends are contributing. Some of them even stay behind to keep forces at bay while the rest of you proceed. And on the topic of group effort, I couldn't have made it here without Darkdramon Bobblebog and Boltmon Jurati across both of my systems. With this help, I was finally able to take on VTM across this multi-phased boss fight, which not only revealed even more of their personality and sense of identity, but we got to see their boobs. Yeah, but Digimon designers couldn't help themselves, could they? But with that, the game draws to a close. All us humans got to return to the real world, and Bobblebog was able to survive the curse of dying. Well, that's all on PSP, because on 3DS, the game moves on to what I like to call post-game, but since the credits haven't rolled yet, it's more fair to call this like an extra final act. Here we're greeted by two new animated cutscenes, one of which shows us the real world being affected by something out of this world. You see, the moment VDM was defeated, someone lying in wait took over to enact their terrible plans, this being Barbamon, one of the demon lords. He was just lying in wait, and didn't let a moment of peace resume once VDM was defeated. Looks like we have a bunch more game left. And unfortunately, it's generally of a lower quality than what came before, at least to me. Granted, I love the story here, and as I've said multiple times, the 3DS version is generally better for all the extra content, which is a game changer. It's just that the main story on PSP is consistently fun, whereas on 3DS, it begins to drag a little more at this final chapter. I'll give them credit though. We get to do more than just explore area, defeat VTM, and repeat. This is all original, and we don't get any new zones, but it recontextualizes old areas. This is great on paper, it's just the execution could have been much better. We have objectives, like fishing for a huge fish to give the two arguing Digimon before they can come to an agreement. Fishing is fine as a distraction, but not when it's mandatory. Especially when the fish being big enough is entirely up to chance. The game also tasks us with making lots of these potions at Wizardmon's place, and this is just a fetch quest with the extra perk of being told you have to wait until the next day to collect the item that you came there for. Like I said, this could have been handled a lot better. We even, and I can't believe it, we have to be mean to a scared Wormmon. That's uncalled for. I love Wormmon, I never want to be mean to him. Though after we scare him, we do have to do several trips through the Dark World here, which is this cool atmospheric void of nothingness, and it repeats endlessly, unless you go in a specific direction you're told of. It is a really cool place the first time you're here. But later on, you'll have to leave where you are, come here again, run a single direction in a void, and then return and go back to wherever you were. This void got boring fast when I had to keep coming back. That said, the story props it up enough to justify it, and this all serves as great falling action after the previous climax. And then we get a new climax for this new endgame, and it's good. In fact, as much as I praise the original for the whole group feeling involved in its epic final confrontation, here it's magnified. I wasn't just controlling Kim Nabizelmon. In small sections here, I had to play as each of the group of friends and use their specific Digimon in these mini-boss encounters. And it was so nice to see the game go to this extra step. Rather than tell us they did something cool off-screen, we got to see it. We got to play it. And after all that, we get a climactic final boss moment that is more spectacular than the previous one. Even if my Beezlemon is far too powerful and made this boss fight way too easy. After all this, both worlds are restored, and we get the same ending as before, though we've added Rena, this green-haired girl who showed up in the 3DS game's final chapter. She's here now, that's nice. Oh, and Purple-haired woman, her ending is a little different here, to better reflect her role in all these 2010s Digimon games where she shows up. And this would be the end of it, but because these are awesome games, they both have New Game Plus. Here, you have to replay the game with some of the previous stats carrying over, like your Digimon will start off quite a bit more powerful, and any moves they've already unlocked will carry over too. But once again, as I keep saying, the 3DS version took this and turned it to 11. Because not only does it do that, and not only does it give us the option to replay the game on a newly introduced hard mode, but we also get to play as Rina, the green-haired girl, and start off with her V-mon instead of the Agumon of before. In this version, the roles are reversed. The male protagonist will now be the one who posts on Digiter constantly from the real world, and presumably, he'd join the game at the very end, much like Rina did. I say presumably, because I'm not doing 3 whole playthroughs of this game for this video, so I have no idea how post-game ends, but I assume it'd have to be that way. This Rina campaign is largely cosmetic, but it's a really fun bonus. And in this version, the sexist guy is still a sexist, but not to you, because you're one of the good ones. Probably because Rina's design leaves little to the imagination. And on that note, if it wasn't obvious, I love these games. Digimon World 1 was one of those games that defined my childhood, that I will never not love it. But here it is with the corners rounded off a little, and in a beautiful 3D world, with lots of small quality of life improvements. This game isn't for everyone, but it is near perfect for the kinds of people who want this exact formula. Unfortunately, the PSP version isn't as good. In a vacuum, it would be, but we have to deal with the fact that a version of this game exists that is better in almost every single way. So unless you love the PSP even more than me, or if you want to understand the history and see the differences between this and the enhanced version, I can't think of a reason why you'd play the PSP version today. The 3DS runs circles around it, it even has a Parrotmon who takes you to places, and it has Wormmon, I love it. Speaking of games that got enhanced versions, next time I'm looking at Clock Tower. The original Super Famicom version is one of my favourite games of that era, and it got an enhanced remake for PlayStation, which added nice extras. Anyway, the enhanced PlayStation version of the Super Famicom game got remade again, but this time for Bandai Wonderswan. Look, it's portable! I found a loophole to talk about Clock Tower! So join me next time for my first video on the Bandai Wonderswan, an amazing little system that doesn't get the love it deserves.